name of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world. Amen. Jesus is going on a journey, and if you're going to go with him, you have to learn to pack light. Any of you who have taken a pilgrimage or taken a long trip on foot know that that's not just a spiritual truth. It's quite practical. The less you carry, the easier the journey will be. Jesus knows this, and he wants you to be carrying as little baggage as possible if you're going to follow him on the way. This is a fundamental truth of the life of faith, although it's a difficult truth, especially in a world where more is always better. But with Jesus, the goal is to be unlike the world. And that's because Jesus is journeying to a kingdom a long way off where quite different things are going on. Festivals at which the poor man is king and the consumptive is healed, a place where there are mirrors in which the blind look at themselves and love looks at them back, among many other mind-bending activities. Jesus wants everyone to be on this journey with him to that kingdom, Jew and Gentile, rich and poor, the sick, the healthy, the little children, and the grown-up children. And yes, even this rich young man who comes rushing up to Jesus today. Jesus wants all of us on the journey, but there is a learning curve. You see, even before we start packing, we have to figure out who we're traveling with. That's what our rich young man's real struggle is. He knows he's been keeping the law. He knows that God has richly blessed him with material goods. He also knows his soul is in distress, and he knows where he wants to go. He earnestly desires to inherit eternal life. These are all good things to know. But this young man is missing one thing. He doesn't know the one he wants to travel with. He reveals this in the moment that he falls before Jesus. The man asks, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" What does he call Jesus? Good teacher. He's half right. Jesus is a good rabbi, but he's unlike all the other rabbis roaming around Judea at this time. That's because he's not just a man like every other man, just a little wiser and a little holier. Rather, Jesus has, in word and action, declared that he is the Son of Man, the promised Messiah, sent to bring about the kingdom of God. But despite everything this young man knows, he doesn't yet know the truth about Jesus' identity. So Jesus tries to bring him along. "Why do you call me good?" Jesus asks. "No one is good except God alone." In other words, no one who's just a man could be truly good. "If you're coming to me because I'm a good man," says Jesus, "then you're coming for the wrong reason. But if you're coming because I and the Father are one, then we can start packing and get this show on the road." You see, Jesus is only worth traveling with if he truly is God and can lead his fellow travelers to an eternal good, to the kingdom of God. But Jesus can see the rich man's heart. He can see the distress of his soul. He can see the desire to inherit eternal life. But he can also see that the young man has effectively chosen another God and another kingdom, himself. The man has chosen his own way, which was not the way of Christ. His eyes are turned downward to the things of this world. The man believes in doing rather than dying to inherit the kingdom of heaven. And this becomes a little clearer when Jesus lays out the commandments for him. Do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not bear false witness, do not defraud, honor your father and your mother. Notice that that's all the second table of the law, the commandments dealing with our relationship with our neighbor. And the man has been a good neighbor. "Teacher, all these I have kept from my youth," he says. He has kept the law as well as a young sinner can keep the law. But what part of the law has he ignored? "You shall have no other gods. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy." those commandments that have to do with our relationship with God, those commandments weren't on the young man's radar. That's because there was no room for God in the young man's self-centered, rule-following religion. He had chosen the solitary path, certainly full of countless people for whom he did many nice things. But at the end of the day, he was traveling nowhere all alone. He became his own idol, and that was the greatest barrier to knowing and believing in Jesus for who he truly was, true God and true man, come to redeem the world from sin. "You lack one thing," Jesus told him. What was that one thing? Quite simply, it was faith. The man had the law, he had the means, he had the longing, and he had the zeal, but he had no faith that confessed Jesus as the Son of God. To him, Jesus was just another good man, a great teacher who could show him a few more things about the good life. But the young man believed in his own conception of the good life rather than God's. He believed in himself, in his works, and in his wealth. If he could only have confessed that he had made himself a god, perhaps he could have seen the true God in the humble body of Christ and believed in him. And Jesus does try to lead the man out of himself. Looking at him and loving him, Jesus says, "Go, sell all that you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me." There's nothing special about this call. The price was the usual price, the price we must all pay. The young man had to free himself from everything that bound him to the past and give himself entirely to the new path that lay before him. But the price was too high, so he walked away disheartened. The word that Mark uses there essentially means darkened. The bright shining face, the expectation, the excitement faded, and he was sorrowful. I think we have here one of the most beautiful and yet devastating moments in the entire gospel. Jesus knows this man through and through. He knows that the young man is going to reject the call to follow him. And what does Jesus do in the face of that rejection? He doesn't turn away. He doesn't abandon. Jesus looked at him, loved him, and kept on calling. This is how you know Jesus truly is God in human flesh. Only the true God could look unbelief in the eye and still love this poor young man. No human could do that. Only God could encounter idolatry and pride and still call the man to follow him. That is true goodness. That is true beauty. A love that faces rejection and still desires to travel together on a new and better way. You see, Jesus is going on a journey, but it's no walk in the park. He's traveling the way to the cross. And on that way, there's very little that you need. You don't need your health or your wallet. You don't need a change of clothes. You need only know who you're traveling with. You need only to repent of your idolatry and believe and confess that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Because it's not just a good teacher dying for you. Christ is the incarnate God hanging on the cross for you. And Christ's death is all you need. And you have died that death with him in baptism. And we keep on dying with him in repentance. And though life may continue to drag you through the valley of the shadow of death, the journey always ends in resurrection. In the holy name of Jesus, amen.